Hello, I'm R.L. Stine. I write the Goosebumps books.
Although it seems he's not the only one writing them. Sure, they've sold more than 400 million copies worldwide, second only to Harry Potter.
You're a wizard, Harry.
I'm a what?
But publisher Scholastic's made over 100 edits to remove references to mental health, weight and ethnicity. So characters who were overweight are now huge, and the word crazy was replaced with silly or scary as part of an effort to make the series more appropriate for today's youth.
Sorry, folks.
Harrison doesn't live here anymore.
But shocked fans took to Twitter, accusing Stine of bowing to woke culture before a just-as-shocked Stine revealed he hadn't made the edits and that Scholastic had gone behind his back. In short, no one was fine.
I'm sure they'll be just fine.
After similar changes to Roald Dahl's work, a debate about censorship is heating up, with some arguing this is another example of cancel culture.
I think I wouldn't call this cancel culture. It's a very natural process for children's books to be heavily monitored and controlled by adults. From the Brothers Grimm editing fairy tales in the 19th century to remove all the sexual content, through to working on authors like Enid Blyton in the 1960s. So this latest round of changes are not actually new.
But when it comes to children's literature, some believe special care needs to be taken.
Us scholars of children's literature tend to talk about children's books as socialisers, so they're part of how we teach children about the world and their place in it. Who is good, who is bad, and therefore children's books are pretty hotly contested.
For Goosebumps fans desperate to get that first time feeling, there's still hope, with legal experts noting that when the copyright runs out, the original versions become available again. Though given that could be as long as 70 years after R.L. Stine dies, today's Goosebumps obsessives won't be around to see that, right?
Well, someone with an opinion or two about this sort of stuff, would you please welcome Australian author Kathy Lette.
Yeah. Hey, hi. First time on the project. Welcome. So happy. Project version, yeah.
Great to see
you. Be gentle with me.
Whether we're talking about Roald Dahl or Goosebumps, as is the case today, where do you sit on this? Sanitising the language for kids?
Well, I think it's time the woke took a little nap. You know, when it comes to literature, I mean, it's really great that the younger generations have woken society up to our hypocrisies and our inequalities and stuff. But when it comes to books, really, hit the snooze button. Let readers make their own minds up, I would say. For example, would Puberty Blues ever get published now? I mean, I don't think it would in this current climate, because the depictions of the racism and the sexism on the beaches of the 70s are so graphic. Sensitivity readers would be like having a collective cardiac arrest, you know, they'd be hospitalised. So, you know, and it's the raw realism of that book that's given it its longevity.
So you haven't had a sensitivity reader come to you and say, listen, we're going to re-release Puberty Blues and we've got a few tweaks we'd like to make.
How would they do it? I mean, imagine dipping me in disinfectant. Imagine, like, take a classic Puberty Blues line, like, rack off, you fish-faced mole. What would that be like? Please leave my presence, you aquatically themed sexual adventurers. I mean, it just doesn't... And in the surfy vernacular, well, you're a shyer boy. You know, in the surfy vernacular, if a good-looking girl walked by, the surfy guy would go, gee, she's rootable. You know, what would you change?
I certainly wouldn't, to be clear.
How would you advise that? That would be like, oh, your pulchritudinous properties are stirring my nether regions. I mean, it just is not going to work, is it? Just doesn't cut the linguistic mustard.
I have to disagree. I'm really into what you just said.
You're a Conan the Grammarian, obviously. Yeah.
Just going back to Goosebumps, they've replaced the word crazy with silly and the word overweight, which apparently is problematic, with huge.
Yeah.
What do you think about that?
Well, why can't they just... Readers don't have to strap a giant shock absorber to their brains when they're reading a book. Trust the author to take you from cover to cover with emotional intelligence, empathy and integrity. You do not need this kind of censorship. They call them sensitivity readers, but they're sensorivity. They're censoring all the time.
You're someone that loves to play with words, right? And you construct the sentences and you dance on the line, right, where it gets cheeky. It can be so easily crossed today, right? Do you think twice about what you are saying now, whether it's in an interview or writing it?
Of course. Well, actually, I can. I do have what I call the black belt in tongue foo.
Yeah.
So I can give... I know, women are good at that because we're more verbally dexterous than men. We have about 350 more words in our daily vocabulary. Sorry, boys. Another reason why we're superior. But so... Well, you're from the Shire. You have a three-grunt vocabulary, not...
No joking.
But I can triple an entendre, so I can play with words in that way.
So is there a solution to this? Like, if there's stuff that exists that's problematic that we don't want to get rid of, yeah, we want to keep, but we want to kind of deal with the stuff that I guess is changing and that maybe young people don't accept anymore.
Well, there are okay, there's a couple of exceptions. Things like Agatha Christie's title that used the N-word. Well, that should never have been condoned. And there's also things like, I would say I worry about the fact that authors now are not allowed to write a character who doesn't have your own ethnicity and your sexual orientation. So that means things like Uncle Tom's Cabin could never have been written. That book helped change and end slavery, but it could never be written because it was written by Harriet Beecher Stowe. So I think we should stop grounding authors' flights of imagination. You know, let us take flight and see where it leads us. But I do think when it comes to non-fiction, anything that glorifies colonisation, that should have an urgent rewrite with an Indigenous, you know, Indigenous take on it. But apart from that, no. You know, let readers make up their own minds, don't you think? I hope you're going to slip between my covers.
I don't know what you mean by that. This is one of those entendres I've heard of.
Satisfaction guarantee.
I certainly can't promise that.
Would you please thank the wonderful, the one and only Kathy.
Yay. You know I love you, Charlie.